Finally, the mother of all divorce settlements is over. Although they're still technically Mr. and Mrs. McCartney, the divorce isn't expected until May. A High Court judge has ruled on who gets what from their four-year marriage. Heather Mills McCartney was awarded £24.3 million, but she had demanded £125 million.
He also said that Paul is only worth £400 million. And that is what he said he believes him to be worth. Everybody knows he's been worth £800 for the last 15 years.
Inconsistent, inaccurate, and less than impressive. Just some of the words used by the judge, Mr. Justice Bennett, to describe Heather Mills' evidence in court.
Good evening, Heather Mills. It's her own worst enemy, a woman devoid of reality who indulges in make-believe. The damning verdict from the judge who presided over her bitter divorce from Sir Paul McCartney.
As the case reached its climax and tension mounted in the court, it was reported that Heather threw a glass of water over Paul's QC, Fiona Shackleton.
Passionate love has turned into passionate hatred, and that does not facilitate a smooth divorce.
This has been a dirty war with propaganda, distortions, and wild accusations.
The fact that Heather married a Beatle, I think, was a recipe for disaster.
Heather will soon become the ex-Lady McCartney, with a life story that could have been written for Hollywood. But what's the real story?
One particular girl was told by Heather that she worked for The Observer, and this person said, no, you don't.
There was never any 3D kidnap. What she wrote was lies.
She's the lady who cried wolf too much.
You read her life story and you think, goodness me, how can so much have happened to one person?
The sheer audacity of it just beggars belief. It's mind-blowing.
Topless model, disabled campaigner, married to the richest Beatle, then the sensational split. Tonight, the files on the ex-Lady McCartney. After a very public battle over 2 years, Heather Mills has millions of pounds, but at what cost to her reputation? The judge agreed she gets a bad press, ridiculed and vilified, but he said that to some extent she's her own worst enemy. She's an explosive and volatile character. Heather Mills has come far, from a poor background on Tyneside and a mother who abandoned her when she was nine. A modelling career offered her a way out. But in 1993, an accident changed her life.
Just 2 weeks ago, Heather Mills was knocked down by a police motorcycle. Her left foot was severed on impact, and doctors were forced to amputate her leg below the knee.
For many people, such an accident would be devastating, but not Heather. She turned her disability to her advantage in her TV career, winning praise for gutsy performances like this.
You can pop it off.
I can't believe you just did that. That's amazing.
She reinvented herself. She thought, this is the beginning, I can start all over again now. And it sounds very callous to say it, but actually I think she was quite brutal about how she approached the rest of her life.
Nearly 76,000 of these were handed
out. By the late 90s, Heather began to fulfil her dreams of fame. She landed a job as a TV reporter.
Even though it's a glorious day, it is blooming freezing here. And I've got Tommy.
But was TV fame enough for her? At the same time as she was appearing on screen, another Heather Mills was winning a reputation as a hard-hitting journalist on The Observer. A remarkable coincidence.
She saw the woman, a woman who was doing quite well in her career, working for a national newspaper, had the same name as her. Well, hell, why not? Get in there. I mean, you got to love it. It's, the thing about Miss Mills McCartney is that she's... you couldn't make her up. She's just a brilliant character. Just genius.
One particular girl who was a television presenter, a very famous one, said she met her at a party and was told by Heather that she worked for The Observer. And this person said, no, you don't. And Heather said, yes. So she said, no, you don't.
And the sheer audacity of it just beggars belief. It's mind-blowing. And actually, once you get over the kind of shock of it, it's actually hysterically funny, unless you happen to be Heather Mills, The Observer journalist.
And this is Heather Mills, the Observer journalist. Soon she began to hear the rumours. There was another Heather Mills in town, and people were getting them confused.
I was just amused by it, really. Didn't kind of seem to be her thing, really, writing about prisons and poverty and terrorism, as
you know, not something I would have associated her with particularly.
The situation took a twist when Heather applied for another TV presenting job. The man doing the interviewing had a partner, and it just so happened that she was a friend of The Observer's Heather Mills.
And I said, oh, hi, Heather, Heather. You know my partner, Moira, don't you? She could, I guess, have turned around and said, oh, no, you've got me mixed up. That isn't me. But no, she sort of said nothing. And me, being the man I am, faced with a sort of rather good-looking young woman like this, just continued to talk on, really. At no stage did he ever tell a lie to me. But nevertheless, she allowed me to continue in this misapprehension. But there was, of course, one way of checking. I said to Moira, you didn't tell me that Heather had only got one leg. And Moira said, oh, don't be ridiculous. She's got two legs. I said, well, how do you know?
Heather denied ever passing herself off as an Observer journalist. But it didn't stop the accusations surfacing in a TV interview.
There's this woman going around, apparently called Heather Milson. Heather's pretending to be me, and I'm like, excuse me?
You know? You admire her chutzpah. She's, you know, she's just an ingenious character at times.
I wrote for the New Statesman, and I wrote as a columnist, and she's trying to say that I was pretending I was her because I said I did journalism. I produced for Current Affairs at the BBC. You know, I'm not making anything up. They are true things.
She made out as if it was all a huge misunderstanding and this other Heather Mills was quite clearly bonkers.
I don't understand it. It didn't do her any good.
Here.
She had her own career. She was like beginning here. To make it in the world. I'm you know, bemused.
While working as a TV reporter on That's Esther, Heather started a relationship with director Chris Terrell. Within 12 days, he'd proposed.
I decided I'd fallen in love with her, and when we were floating down on a fishing boat up the Mekong, I proposed to her.
And she said?
When?
Can we see the ring?
A whirlwind romance, but the events that followed moved even quicker.
They decided they were going to get married in August.
6 days before the wedding, he had his stag night.
Woke up the next day, she was all dressed ready to go, she was going to the airport to pick up her sister,
who was flying in from Greece to come to the wedding.
She said, bye, see you later. He never saw her again because she rang him up and said, it's off.
Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Heather Mills.
By then, Heather had already met Paul McCartney at the Daily Mirror's Pride of Britain Awards. This was his first public appearance since the death of Linda. The attraction was mutual.
Thank you very much. I've been trying to stop crying all year, and I come here.
She couldn't tell the world that she'd dumped Chris Terrell because she'd met multimillionaire Paul McCartney.
Chris Terrell has claimed that Heather came up with a bizarre reason for dumping him. In this newspaper article, he claimed Heather had spread false rumours that he was gay. Whether Heather was behind them or not, the story spread.
Chris is a great admirer of the female form and has a particular appreciation for women's breasts, which is why he and I have always got on so well. But so that's always been, you know, it's always a joke. And he always says, you know, that was one of the things about Heather, that she stuck her chest out and he was lost.
With her former boyfriend out of the way, Heather now had her sights on a different marriage.
I love him.
Oh. On national telly?
You said it.
And this marriage would make her Lady McCartney. But according to Heather, she didn't need Sir Paul to get a gong. In 2001, she told the Sunday Times she was already heading for the House of Lords, thanks to a people's peerage from the Labour government.
I was pretty gobsmacked by the idea that somebody who was essentially just a model and a bit of a part-time campaigner, who was really best known for just being Paul McCartney's girlfriend, should have been offered a peerage, seemed incredible.
Heather was quoted in the Sunday Times as saying she was only 50-50 about accepting a peerage, but that she had support from a Lord Macdonald. We've tracked down all three men who go under that title. One had retired from the Lords 2 years before Heather Mills' claim. Another Lord Macdonald said he'd never had any communication with her.
The only one that could have possibly had any kind of sway was a guy called Gus MacDonald, who I think was a transport minister at the time. The idea that he would have been approaching ex-models suggesting that they should go and sit in the House of Lords is pretty fanciful.
My lords, humanists will resist being...
We've since spoken to Gus MacDonald, a lord since 1998, who said he had no recollection of meeting Heather. He did add that he does meet many people, and Heather may just have slipped his memory. Some questioned if the peerage was an exaggerated claim, but it seems Heather didn't see herself being limited to politics here in Britain.
She said with a very straight face that she had to be very careful not to endorse either candidate in the American presidential election, as if somehow this might have a bearing on the result. And, you know, I kept on waiting for her to kind of smile and say no, joking, but actually, no, she I think she really didn't mean it.
2002, US presidential election safely out of the way, and Heather Mills marries Sir Paul McCartney. She'd finally become a lady, but her past was beginning to catch up with her. By 2003, Heather Mills' life had taken an extraordinary turn. She was married to the world's richest entertainer and had given birth to a baby daughter, Beatrice. But her autobiography, Out on a Limb, described an earlier life even more astonishing.
You read her life story and you think, goodness me, how can so much have happened to one person?
If it was a publisher, I'd say, dear Heather, start writing novels. You'd do very well at it.
Her autobiography gave a headline-making account of a kidnap and molestation back in the 1970s. Heather claimed she and childhood friend Margaret Ambler were victims of a paedophile.
I did go to see a counsellor, and the first thing the counsellor said to me, if it is true what Heather's wrote, don't be afraid to admit it. And I thought, dear God in heaven, it isn't true.
As a young girl, Margaret lived next door to Heather in Washington, Tyne and Wear.
We were very good friends. I was so much into swimming at the time, and Heather loved swimming too.
Heather's book described how their swimming teacher fondled her and took Margaret into his bedroom. She was 7 and Margaret 9.
It started off with sort of things like just, well, what colour knickers have you got on today? And little things like that. And he would insist on taking turns and giving you a piggyback. So his hands was where obviously they shouldn't have been. It did go on for a few months, quite a few months, until it got to the point where he did actually touch myself and Heather. But that was all.
But not according to Heather, who claimed the teacher had imprisoned both girls in his flat for 3 days and nights before they were spectacularly released.
Heather said 6 or 7 police officers came breaking at the door, broke down this door, went into the flat, dramatically rescued her. None of that happened. It really didn't happen. There was never any 3D kidnap. No police breathed down any door.
But more importantly, Margaret Ambler had never told her family of this abuse. Heather named her both in the book and on national television.
You were abducted by a pedophile swimming instructor?
Yeah. Yeah.
Jeez.
When I was about, I think, 7 and a half. But because I was younger, the other girl, Margaret, was like a couple of years older.
And this poor woman who has spent years getting over this is now receiving counselling, you know, years and years after the event, because of Heather blabbing.
Couldn't escape or anything?
No, well, this is the thing. He'd send one of us out and say that he would kill the other one if we didn't come back.
What she wrote was lies. I mean, if she'd wrote the truth, it would have had just as much impact. Yes, I would have been angry because I don't want every man and his wife to know when I was 10 years old that I was abused. I mean, nobody wants people to know that.
Margaret sued because of the invasion of her privacy and the misuse of private information. Heather had to pay £45,000 in damages and legal costs. Heather told us her recollection is true and she only settled because a court case would have cost her even more. When Paul and Heather split in 2006, claiming the breakup was amicable, the media's attitude to her changed. They started delving into her background much more aggressively than before.
People, frankly, were scared of Paul McCartney and the power he wields and his £850 million fortune. And people knew that if they said anything about it, you had to be able to back it up 450%.
But with Paul no longer by her side, the press declared open season on Heather. The News of the World published allegations that she'd been an escort girl, with interviews from people supporting the allegations. Heather Mills strenuously denied all the claims in the News of the World and said that she intended to sue the newspaper. Along with the new headlines, the tabloids published long-forgotten topless photos of Heather.
Good, nice. Yes, yes, yes.
She's never denied being a glamour model, posing for photographers like Jeff Kane back in the 80s.
Gorgeous.
She wasn't shy about anything like that. In fact, she quite boasted about those things in those days.
Heather Mills, Panache Agency.
Right, Heather, give me a few poses.
It was no problem for us to pose her in any pose or with clothes or without clothes. Heather was just one of the girls that would do that job. In those days, it was like 25 girls, and if all of them said no, we were in trouble. But good old Heather, she said yes.
Paul McCartney knew all about this aspect of his wife's background. What he didn't know about was The Joys of Love, a German book she'd posed for. The Sun, publishing it after the couple split, called it hardcore porn. Heather described it as educational.
Whipped cream, strawberries, bondage gear and handcuffs. I didn't get taught that at school, so no, it's not educational. It's pornography.
We've seen the photographs. She can't keep on pretending that photographs of her being spanked and having cream slathered all over her body is to educate people on how to have sex, because it ain't. It was for money for her.
Paul was not for sex. He could not believe the pictures, the interview with her co-star in which he alleged oral sex had been involved. It knocked him absolutely sideways. That was the moment the gloves were off.
The so-called amicable parting now turned bitter, with the private war of words becoming public. Heather's divorce petition was leaked. I know that you can change. It claimed Paul had been a drunk and violent, lunging at her with a broken wine glass, pushing her into a bath. All vehemently denied, the allegations did little to help Heather's image.
People love him all over the world. They don't want to hear he's a drunken oaf who comes back and attacks his wife with a broken glass. They just don't want to hear this.
You read this and thought, it cannot be true. I cannot believe that he pushed and shoved his wife around.
Paul McCartney said the allegations weren't true. Old friends came out in support.
This is just malicious. This is cruel. And it's got to stop. And the only way it can stop is for the public to turn around and make it bloody plain to this woman that we're not going to be affected by what she says.
The 8 pages of allegations were faxed anonymously from this Covent Garden newsagent to the Press Association. The question was, who sent them?
She was brunette, about 5'6" height. She said, do you do fax service? I say, yes, we do fax service. And she had a few pages in her hand. And once she finished, she came here in the front and paid about £8. Then she just went.
It's hard to judge who the leak was from. You know, Heather insisted the leak was not from her.
It definitely didn't come from Heather's side. We were closely guarding all of that documentation.
It remains the sort of Watergate-esque moment of the whole of the McCartney breakup.
And like all good mysteries, there was talk of murder. Heather claimed Paul withdrew money for her security. Now she claimed the lives of her and baby Beatrice were in danger.
We've had a few death threats, which is pretty scary. And considering we don't have any security, we don't have any funding for security at all.
The threats that were made against Heather were threats from a criminal gang. It wasn't just the threats that were going out over the internet by Beatles fans. These were an organised criminal gang.
Sussex police had told Heather they considered the death threats low risk, but they did give her a phone number to contact them when necessary, a number she obviously remembered.
She dialed four times yesterday. Each time the police turned up, but said there was no call for further action. And today, they issued a warning about overusing the service.
It's very rare for a commanding officer to come out and say that she was, you know, there was a disproportionate amount of police time spent on one individual, OK? And that's what was said. That's undisputable.
The Chief Inspector of Sussex told the media that Heather's actions could jeopardise future calls being taken seriously.
He used the example of the little boy who cried wolf. Now, that to me was quite an aggressive statement for a policeman to make.
I do not waste police time. If your family were having death threats and the police have informed you about them, then the police would be keeping an eye on what's going on.
She called the police four times. The most likely explanation for why she would call them is paparazzi photographers. And I've no doubt, and hey, you know, give her a due, that it must be awful, you know, in many ways, having photographers outside your doorstep the whole time.
There are many other celebrities that cope with it and get on with it and live a normal life without having panic buttons and 24-hour police protection.
She insisted that the police were right behind her, but you've only got to read the quotes from the cops. They were really fed up with her.
There was a potential risk to her, and that is why the police made a provision for her to have a panic button. They made provision for her to be able to call if there was a problem. And nobody's ever, as far as I know, had reason to complain.
Whatever the troubles she's faced in Britain since her marriage split, Heather Mills has gone on to enjoy new fame and fortune abroad. The former model, TV presenter, campaigner and Beatle wife proved herself a mistress of reinvention again, this time in the US, where she became a star of America's version of Strictly Come Dancing.
When she did that backflip, it was stupendous. It's a testament to her courage and her determination and her gumption. And when she's in possession of all three of those things, God only knows what she'll do.
She'll always be famous for being the woman who married Paul McCartney and then parted from him more than £24 million richer. It guarantees that whatever Heather does or says next, she'll continue to be big news.
She'd like to be able to influence people, and that is out of the desire to influence change.
She underestimates the public and actually how clever they are and what they will see, and they see straight through her.
She has to know now, and this is a message to her if she's watching this, we check it all out. Remember that.
Heather Mills declined to take part in this programme, but did tell us she denied all the allegations against her. She said she dedicated her last 14 years to charity work, and that's what we should be making programmes about.
This is the end result, and thank you very much.
ITV2's enjoying comedy cuts right now. Well, here next on ITV1, it's your local programme, and then later than billed because of this exclusive, Harry Hill's checking out the week's goings on and preparing for his own type of fight in his TV burp. That's now at 11:40.